or historical developments of that era, which is the fall of the Berlin Wall, and try to kind of conduct a little exercise together with you. All I have the time for is basically to just put some ideas on the table. But first and foremost, like I said, we are talking here about the fall of the Berlin Wall. I'm trying to get my, can you see? This is one of the images here that I want to share quickly before we go into, like I said, the exercise of slightly reframing or changing perspective on what has happened and connecting some dots, transformational dots. So first, to put this into historical context, the idea of potentially unifying Germany and opening up the gates, socio-political gates, was something that was viewed as might be happening in 50 years, potentially. Barely the idea was being raised because the continuation of the threat, of the security threat that was replayed by the media and the political establishment was always reinforced so as to almost not allow that. But contrary to that, many factors played their part in order to move the front in unprecedentedly fast ways. And the consequences of that, I am not going to go into historical facts of what has happened in Hungary, in Czechoslovakia, in Poland, and in my own country, Yugoslavia, one of the greatest social projects of the third way, of the non-alignment founders, of the non-alignment movement, whose ideals have continued, I think, because we have the Southeastern Europe, and we have our own set of issues that have happened. But I really want to quickly just look at what happened in 89 is that the bipolar security order that characterized East-West relationships for 40 years was shattered. And then the fact that the reform efforts in the Eastern Europe depended on the Western response. And how did we respond? I think we can address that quickly, but these are two key points I think I want us to hold our attention on. The drivers behind this, as I'm trying to zoom out rather than focus on details of what has happened in these diverse countries, but rather the drivers of the complex behind this was the particular mindset that drove this, which we know what that was, the military power that polarized psyche, people, and planet, the markets that were created or constricted in a certain way by those ways, the money and the circulation of power through establishment of a certain currency dominance in the world and certain financial institutions in the world, and of course, the media propaganda on all sides that equally, like I said, created the psycho-political polarization, maddening polarization of the world. Now, this is an image should probably pitch you right in the current moment in the world. This is Woodstock for all of you young, eternal youth that are here on the call with me. You would remember this and who and how showed up for women's rights, for economic justice, for racial rights, for peace and dialogue and refusing to participate in this kind of polarization of the world. And our own psyche in the process. And this is an image from the civil rights movement that shows the power of the rainbow of humanity. Speaking of Mampela's metaphors and lived experience, and as they are voicing themselves in harmonizing way and creating that human shield around their idealism. This is, I'm putting us forward next into 1985. This is an image from Live Aid, where for the first time, all the artists from around the world and people came together in reaction to somebody else's pain, which is the famine in Ethiopia. This is the first time all the artists across the division of the Cold War sang together, and it was publicly shown in grand media event, both by people showing up in the public spaces, as well as for the first time we had a major global media and mediatized cultural event. This is, in fact, what rarely is mentioned that set the stage for the fall of the Berlin Wall, in fact. These are the images from that, from people sitting and the youth and all people sitting on the Berlin Wall and crossing over. And this is pitching us into the next stage of human evolution, which is the mediatized individual presence that is individualized or personalized civilization and capacity to self-express through digital media. And this is the Instagram profile of Greta Thunberg, one girl, but I just wanted to point out that there's something wonderful happening here visually, since we are the visual culture and cultural representation. Then the next images on her own Instagram are all the different locations where people showed up in the streets together. So it is one person moving front and creating movements with, at this point, 10 million followers. And this next image is of the famous Oscar-winning actor Leonardo DiCaprio, who is the sweetheart of these girls, the idol, teenage idol of these girls. He's a handsome Oscar-winning actor standing on the stage with them in a completely different environment, in a different context, over a different motivation and inspiration. This is Global Citizen Festival in 2019, when they came together on the stage. This is no longer audience idealizing a handsome actor. They're coming together, unifying in a cultural movement that is both digitalized, as you can see, big media presentation coming together on the same stage. This is no longer pop craze. This is a truly citizen movement of all people that can make impact. Ordinary citizens, 17-year-old, 15-year-old, that are here on the stage with somebody who has a global ambassadorial capacity. And the result is, of course, these remarkable children showing up in the streets. So what I want to point out quickly, zooming out on this collective process, is the power of representation, aesthetic and political, and how they're profoundly interconnecting, and capacity of cultural movements to move political fronts. And equally, once the political fronts are moved, they're setting a new cultural setting and a new climate in which, for example, Mampela was pointing out to us earlier that she's, you know, concerned about the fact that the government can sign or put into action or set into motion certain laws, but the corruption prevents them from implementation. But once things are set in motion politically, the public has every right to show up in the streets and call the government to be accountable for that new standard that is being set. So what has happened, we have seen cultural movement creating space for participation and power. My hope is that the next stage, my expectation, in fact, it is, in my projection, it is, that it will create a heightened, up-leveled and scaled out culture of co-creation and partnership in power, which would be a whole new way of up-leveling in an evolutionary way. And I want to point out these responses now to the drivers that before I show to you. To the old mindset, constricted mindset, we have new consciousness of unity and diversity, which is our motto. We have new consciousness of shared vulnerabilities and shared futures, right? Then, of course, military, we have a new force rising, which is social movements. We have seen so many of them. We have next to markets, we have communities such as, for example, people self-organizing in Greece at the times of terrible economic struggle. We have diversity of perspectives on YouTube and all kinds of ways in which we can individually with our phone. The technology made it possible to voice our perspectives. We have money that is dominated in a certain way, while we now have diversity of asset creation, where to this day, an anonymous entity, Satoshi Nakamoto in 2008, unleashed the technology of blockchain as a way of decentralizing transactions and community building in that sense, and building new economic ecosystems. So what happened when the West, in fact, failed to respond? To what generous arms have been opened in by the perestroika and by the social movements and by the reformation and transformation in that block? The other block, unfortunately, failed to respond. And because of that, we are in the predicament in which we are now. It is because of that, in that the 80s, we regressed or went into certain kind of socioeconomic and political orientation that got us to this place. But life continues to respond, and the world continues to respond, and this is where we are today. On your left, nature taking over plastic, and youth taking over streets. And we are the response of that, I mean, I am, first of all, the child, the product of the fall of the Berlin Wall, as is, in fact, also the World Academy and its values. So quickly, and I don't know that we want to go towards the evolutionary process from dysfunction to coherence and synergy, from violent revolution, which doesn't hold, to conscious evolution, and most importantly, to lead us to this moment, to the Club of Rome and the World Academy. We are engaged through this project, through us right now being together online in the midst of the outbreak of the pandemic. We are actually engaged in a new process of social learning. We are building the notion of global leadership and what it entails in civil society as planetary beings. And we are, the direction we're taking is towards building the new social architecture. This was just my exercise with you, and I appreciate your attention.
Terrific.